We're so glad to have each of you at the Fowler Avenue Baptist Church. On Sunday morning, we meet here in the auditorium. On Wednesday morning, we meet over in the fellowship hall. And we're so glad for those who are able to come today, members of our church, family and friends who've come. We got a missionary that'll be preaching today, and we'll enjoy his service. And we're glad to have my brother, Buddy, he's here today, and all of our friends and guests coming in. Have Chuck and Sandy coming in to be with us, all the way from Brooksville, just about, and others who are here. We are so thankful that you're with us. We're here to magnify the Lord Jesus Christ in testimony and song. There'll be people singing, giving their testimonies, and just have a great time in the Lord. And we're here to magnify Him. The Bible says, "This is good, and accept the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth." There's but one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all. The word ransom, of course, means a price was paid. And the price of our redemption is the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." We're so glad that Christ came, hung on that cross and died, shed his blood, put him in that old tomb. On the third day, he rose again, conquering death, hell, and the grave. We thank God for that. So we're here today to have a good time. I'm going to ask Brother Gerald to come. Let's
506. I will sing of my Redeemer and his wondrous love to me. On the cruel cross he suffered, from the curse to save me. Sing, oh sing, my Redeemer, with his blood he purchased me. On the cross he sealed my pardon, paid the debt and made me free. I will tell the wondrous story, how I love the sick to save.
Thank you. joy to be with you today. I'm so happy to be part of God's children this morning. And I want to say thank you so much, Pastor, for this great opportunity that you have given unto me to share this place with the church. I say I'm really grateful, and I also want to say that I know that I am in the midst of prolific preachers in this house, and I salute all of them in humility. And I also want to thank you all for making it a point to come here to listen to my short testimony. But then before I start, I want to say that indeed I have an accent. So I will please implore you to pay rapt attention to every bit of information I'm putting across, and I believe it's going to be a blessing to you all. So a little bit about me. I was born in a Christian home from the background of the Methodist and the Roman Catholic, but I wasn't saved in either of the two churches because of the kind of controversy surrounding their doctrine of salvation. I cannot earn my way to heaven. It is only Christ that can give me that kind of salvation. So I was kind of confused, and it got to a time that I was going for college in my country and I needed a place to stay. So I knew a friend who knew a Baptist preacher in the city where I was going for college. And my friend spoke to the Baptist preacher concerning me to sort of allow me to stay in their mission house as I go to college. And then staying in the mission house, I was also attending the Baptist church for fear of getting kicked out of the mission house. And one fateful Sunday, the preacher man, who is now my pastor, was preaching from Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9 for his sermon. And I quote, it says, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God." Verse 9 says, "Not of works, lest any man should boast." So he spoke extensively on the topic of our salvation being solely by the grace of God. And that day, I trusted Christ for my salvation. And I walked up to the pastor and told him, "Pastor, I have now understood the whole thing. I need you to get me baptized to start my Christian journey." So I got baptized in the Baptist church, and I'm still a member of that Baptist church in my country. I came to the United States to be trained for the ministry. I came for my master's degree in Christian missions, and I am done and I'm going home. My college is situated in Chicago, Illinois. And the name of my college is Day Spring Bible College and Seminary, presided over by Dr. Phil Stringer. So I came there to be trained for the ministry, and I am done and getting ready to go home in the first week of May. And so I will need you to partner with me in prayers, so that anytime you go on your knees to say a prayer, please remember me and my family, because the work in Ghana is very enormous. There are some villages in my country that, as I'm talking to you now, has no Bible-believing church in those villages. And the Lord has impressed upon my heart to go back to such villages to start ministry, to plant independent fundamental Baptist churches in all those villages. So please and please again, anytime you go on your knees, remember me and my family and pray for us. So that's a little bit about me. This morning, I want us to share something briefly. If you don't mind, can you be on our feet so that we read the word of God from Luke chapter 8, verse 22 to 27, if you don't mind. Shall we be on our feet to read the word of God? Luke chapter 8, verse 22 to 27. Luke chapter 8, verse 22 to 27. This story in the Bible really challenges me in life. It's one of the stories in the Bible that I really love, and I want to share a little bit with all of us. So Luke chapter 8, verse 22 to 27, and I read, "Now it came to pass on a certain day," excuse me, "that he went into a ship with his disciples, and he said unto them, Let us go over unto the other side of the lake. And they launched forth. But as they sailed, he fell asleep. And there came down a storm of wind on the lake, and they were filled with water and were in jeopardy. And they came to him and awoke him, saying, Master, Master, we perish. Then he arose and rebuked the wind and the raging of the water, and they ceased, and there was a calm. And he said unto them, Where is your faith? And they, being afraid, wondered, saying one to another, What manner of man is this? For he commanded even the winds and water, and they obey him. And they arrived at the country of the Gadarenes, which is over against Galilee." Verse 27. "And when he went forth to land, there met him out of the city a certain man, which had devils long time, and wore no clothes, neither abode in any house, but in the tombs." Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this blessed day you've given unto us. We ask that may your Holy Spirit come and teach us your word. And at the end of the day, we shall have every cause to thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Shall we please take our seat? So this morning, I titled my message, "Let Us Go Over to the Other Side." The Bible says that now it came to pass. But before I delve into the message, I want to share a little bit about something that I've really realized from the Bible. That anytime God wants to do something, he calls an individual and then tells the individual, "What I want to do." When God wanted to deliver the children of Israel from Egypt, he preserved the life of one man called Moses. And when he grew up, he told him that this is my plan. This is what I want you to do. Go back to Egypt and redeem my people for me. When God was tired with the ways of mankind, he sent his only begotten son, Jesus Christ, to come to the world to die for the sins of humanity. That the Bible says that whoever recognizes him as his savior, the Bible says that that person is saved and forever saved. So many a times when God wants to do something, he calls an individual. He doesn't call a group of people. Just one single person tells him his plan, and then he goes on to execute that plan, and we see it running throughout the Bible. So this story that we read, it's about one man who was an evangelist in disguise. And by some accident of history, this man was bedeviled with so many devils to the extent that he couldn't do what God has destined him to do. But Jesus Christ came to the scene, and then he was able to do what he was destined to do. So many a times, when God wants to do something, he does it through an individual. And the Bible says that it came to pass. So it came to pass means that it really happened. It wasn't a parable. That one day, Jesus Christ proposed a journey and told his disciples, "Let us go over to the other side of the lake." And the Bible says that they launched forth. But as they launched forth, the Bible says, there arose a storm of wind. The first thing I want to talk about here is that there are times that challenges in our lives prove to us that we are getting it right. It is not always true that when you are going through some challenge, that means that your spiritual life has gone down. Don't let the devil lie to you. Don't let the religious people crucify you to tell you that you are backslidden. No, many a times this story is teaching us that in many cases, when we are on the right path and getting it right, those challenges and the storms that come on our way tells us that we are getting it right. And so sometimes when a storm hits us, we tend to ask ourselves so much questions. Why me? I am a good Christian. I am a faithful giver to the church. I give to missions. Why this storm? And then we tend to question God. And then when we question God and then we do not understand his ways, many a times we become so bitter against God to the extent that sometimes we even want to give up on God. But I want us to learn something from this story, that many a times the challenges that come our way tells us that we are on the right path. We are getting it right. Now, if the storm came for Jesus, it should not be unusual when a storm comes over believers. You will think that because Jesus Christ was in the boat, the storm will not come. But the storm came for him. So if the storm came for Jesus, it should not be something ordinary, or it should not be something unusual when a storm comes over believers. When you are on the right path, the storm will come. And I read this story and I got to realize that a storm is made up of two major components. One, there is the wind, and then there is the water. And I like something Jesus Christ did when he woke up, when the disciples went to him and then woke him up from his sleep, shouting on top of their voice, "Master, Master, carest not that we perish." And the Bible says that when Jesus Christ awoke from the sleep, he rebuked the wind. When you read the text very carefully, you will see that he rebuked the wind, not the water. So it tells me and you that whatever storm you're going through, there are two things that come into contact to each other that gives us, or that forms the storm. And so Jesus Christ is teaching us that for us to deal with any storm, we must rebuke the wind. The force behind the wind, that makes the water boisterous. You see, the water stands for the obvious problem that we see. And the wind also stands for the force behind the storm that we do not see. And Jesus Christ is giving us practical example as to how we can deal with storm. That in dealing with storm, you don't tackle the obvious problem, but you tackle the force that is behind the water, making it boisterous. So Jesus Christ rebuked the wind, and the Bible says that the raging of the storm, or the raging of the water, ceased. But I like something the disciples did. When they saw that this storm was so much for them, to the extent that they cannot solve it by themselves, they put aside all their knowledge in sailing. They put aside all their pride and call upon Jesus Christ. And then the Bible says that Jesus Christ rebuked the wind and the raging of the water ceased. And then he asked them a simple question. Where is your faith? You know, faith is something valuable in our Christian walk. When you are going through any storm, the devil does not care about your children, or the devil does not care about your business. He doesn't care about whatever you have. All that he cares is your faith. And that if he can interrupt your faith, he is done with you. So Jesus Christ asks a simple question. Where is your faith? I don't want to teach on faith this morning. Time will not permit me to talk about faith. But you know, like the Bible says, faith cometh by hearing. So cometh means that it is alive. When somebody speaks, you get to hear it, and then you act upon that word. So, in dealing with storms, you must first of all acknowledge the fact that there is a force behind that storm that must be dealt with. And this can only be dealt with our faith, exercising our faith in Jesus Christ. And the Bible says Jesus Christ was fast asleep, and the disciples were shouting on top of their voice, "Don't you care that you will perish?" And he knew he will never perish. Why? It reminds me of this scripture in the Bible that yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil. And the Bible says that let this mind be in you as it was in Christ Jesus. What was the kind of mentality that Christ had to the extent that he was sleeping in the midst of the raging of the storm? Let us have the mind of Christ in us, so that when the storm comes, and then we can encourage ourselves that yea, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we shall fear no evil. And left with the disciples alone, I believe they would have returned, because they couldn't have bared the storm. And the storm only came as a destructive element to have prevented them from going to the other side to accomplish a certain task. And many a times when the storm hits us, we want to relent, we want to give up. But brothers and sisters, the same energy it takes to go back is the same energy it takes to move forward. Whether you are going back or forward, you're going to exert some kind of energy. And so when the storm hits us, we must remember the same energy it takes to relent is the same energy it takes to move forward. And the Bible says they finally arrived at the other side of the lake. In the midst of all the storm, when Jesus was called into the equation, the storm was managed and they got to the other side of the lake. And now when they got to the other side of the lake, I thought it was the prime minister of that nation going to meet them at the shore. But it wasn't the prime minister. I thought it was a prominent person that was going to meet them at the other side, but it wasn't so. The Bible says that it was a madman that met them at the other side of the lake. And this man ran to Jesus. To cut a long story short, this man ran to Jesus, prayed. Jesus prayed for him, cast all the devils from him, and then Jesus gave him an instruction. I want you to go back to your family where you are coming from and tell your people what Christ has done for you. And the Bible says that Jesus Christ, after doing this, he told his disciples, let us go back. So I asked myself this question. Why would Jesus Christ propose a journey that puts him and then his disciples in a jeopardy? Just to come and free one person, just to come and free one man. It tells me that, you know, life is not all about us. Whenever you think that life is all about you, my brothers and sisters, please look beyond you, because people's destinies are connected to us. You may be going through the storm today, not because it's all about you, but because somebody needs to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so Jesus Christ gave me an instruction. Go back and tell your people what Christ has done for you. But where was Jesus' vision when he proposed this journey? Where was the grace or the vision that saw Nathanael under a tree? I believe Jesus Christ knew everything. He saw everything. Yet still, he proposed the journey. Let us go over to the other side. My brothers and sisters, whenever you think that the storm you're going through today is all about you, please look beyond you. It's not all about you. The devil just brings storms on our way to distract us from going to the other side to preach the gospel, to tell somebody about Jesus Christ. And the Bible says that this man went back and published in the whole city of the Gadarenes what Christ has done for him. So now let's reverse the story. Story. Once upon a time in the country of the Gadarenes, when God wanted to invade that land, when God wanted to introduce Christ to that city, he invested his dreams and goals in one man. But like I said earlier on, by some accident of history, the devil worked at the background of this man so that he could not do what God has purposed him to do. But thanks be to God that Jesus Christ came to the scene. And when Jesus Christ came to the scene and he was freed, this man, who was an evangelist in disguise, went back to his town and introduced Christ to the country of the Gadarenes. The storm is not all about you. It's all about somebody who needs to hear the gospel. And whenever you think that it's all about you, like I said, look beyond you. If Christ was able to inconvenience himself to go to the other side in the midst of all the storm to free one man, to introduce himself to the country of the Gadarenes, then my brothers and sisters, we have no excuse. He has given us practical ways of dealing with storm in order to introduce Christ, to preach the gospel to one single soul. Let us go out there today, the whole of this week, preach the gospel to one person who is equal to a whole family. Preach the gospel today to an individual who will be equal to a whole community. It's not all about you and me. It's all about an individual. And victory over storm has a purpose. So if you are able to conquer all the storms, it has a purpose. And the purpose is for Christ to be revealed. Let us go over to the other side of our ministry, of our prayer life, of our witness to the lost, and preach the gospel for a soul to be saved. Thank you very much for listening to this short sermon, and I believe you will be challenged by it, and then preach the gospel to all and sundry. Thank you very much.
We're so thankful for the message that was given to us by our missionary brother. We're thankful for you being with us today. We come to the time where we close out like we normally do, and a lot of repetition, but it's part of the service. Again, we say thank you for coming to be with us today. Thank you for your message, uplifting Christ and pointing people to Jesus. And so you pray for our missionary, pray for all of our missionaries, pray for our church family, pray for those going through special times. We're going to have a word of prayer, and then we're going to have Brother Gerald come up, and we'll have an invitation time. Our Father, we come in Jesus' name, thanking you for this time we can look into our heart and ask the question, do we really know Jesus Christ as our Savior? Not just know about him and know of him, but do I know that I've asked him to come into my heart and save me? Our Father, we pray that people listen, watching the video, people here today, if they're doubting their salvation, may they drive the stake down today and say, this day, I reaffirm my faith in Christ. Pray this simple prayer. Lord Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. I believe that you came and died on that cross. They put you in the tomb on the third day, you rose again, conquering death, hell, and the grave. Lord Jesus, it's your blood that was shed to cleanse us and buy us out of the slave market of sin. Our Father, we pray that this man, each of us today, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I'm not trusting water baptism. I'm not trusting religion. I'm trusting Jesus. He did all the work. He's the one who died, who shed his blood, and rose again that third day. Lord Jesus, come into my heart and save me right now. Father, those that have done that today, may they find a good Bible-believing church. May they get into the Word of God and begin to grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. There may be someone here today that needs to make that decision. Pray you'll lead and guide in this invitation. We'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.